First of all, I want to thanks for being invited to this fantastic seminar. It's been extremely creative and very inspiring to hear all different thoughts. And I think that my presentation will partly link to Andreas, right, and also Rune's presentation, which takes on a more non-representational approach towards artistic research. And as you said, Henrik, I'm gonna reflect on some central thoughts from my PhD or my thesis before sound, transversal processes inside specific sonic practice. I'm a sound installation artist, and we'll come back to that. But generally, in art, we often talk about the capacity of art to alter something, to change something, to make a difference, and that's what I'm going to talk about. What does this actually mean, or what are the insights of doing that from the artistic practitioner's perspective, and in what way can insights from that actually alter the idea of the practice and also the practicing of sound installation as a site-specific practice? Many expectations, so we see if I manage to fulfill them. So my contribution is, as mentioned, some thoughts from this PhD thesis that I pursued at the Gothenburg University Academy of Music and Drama. And I would like to claim that in order to being able to transform a site, to understand the capacity of transformation, my outset today is that we need to understand the complex transversal processes that kind of foregrounds the practice, that takes place before sound. In that sense, you can understand the sonic work or sound as an extremely interrelational complex process, which in many ways could be described as a virtuous practice, a virtuos practice, elaborating, dealing with very different spheres, connecting the material perspectives, the social, the discursive, textual, and of course the artistics and technology. So I'm going to start to show you the oldest work in my Baunschau project that I pursued. It's called Currents, and that's also when I realized that I'm absolutely plus 40, because it was made in 2011, and I don't think that's very long time ago, but nevertheless. You can push up the volume 3 dB. Currents from 2011, one of four projects that I formed the kind of core of my PhD project. And it's also in somehow the project in many ways mirrors my artistic practice as a site, as installation, dealing with site specificity. I've been working for more than a decade, almost 15 years specifically, exploring site specific as a practice, and I think I'm doing around 25 different site-specific projects. They are extremely different in this way, different kinds of places from, North Atlantic current as site, libraries, the sky as a site, more ordinary skies as a park or a churchyard and so, but what's the common point is has always been my interest in how can you transform a site or a place through means of sound and listening. I always felt that what actually causes and what evokes the possibility of transformation lies in these very tiny details. For instance, how you can install a loudspeaker cable or not. This is an excerpt from the Oslo Opera. I think it was in the 6:30 in the morning. In the end, we had to avoid installing loudspeakers in one part of the building, which of course dramatically alters the spatial experience of the site. Or the fact that this is my daily working, my office situations, and what happens when it starts to rain, in what way does the way I'm working and directly interact with the soundscape on the site affect the outcome of the work. I always try to work in a very long, during long processes on site, and I always use the same technology in the beginning. I don't have a kind of studio equipment or something like that. I directly try to use the same technology as from beginning to end. Or what does it actually imply then when you have to install 1 kilometer cables and all these kinds of negotiations? You see, I like cables, loudspeaker cables. Or another tiny fact, the fact that for as in this work, the well, which it's a permanent installation at the Swedish Institute in Paris, just one speaker installation with a tiny loudspeakers installed in the bottom of the well. But the fact that also a well has its agency, and it caused enormous problems to deal with the stone walls in order to get a certain effect, or the fact that you have to let it go. So in the, all these kind of tiny details, I would say that very essential part of the practice lies. And this in somehow, I feel when we talk about spatial practices and also site specificity, even though it's a kind of tradition of practices that runs from the 60s until today, these kind of embedded tiny details, which are the central for the practice, are very kind of suppressed or not mentioned at all. And that's what I needed to find out. And it could be also described as the kind of core of for my research project. And I would say that there are there are a couple of kind of ideas which kind of dominates the notion of spatial production. And I'm talking about site specificity, connecting it slightly to the discourse on public space and so on. And which I, in my research project, terms normalization, commercialization, and simplified forms of representations. And it's simply that, for instance, when we talk about normalization, sound art and sound installations today, they are quite common art forms today. If you compare to like 10 or 15 years ago, there was much more insecurity or unsure what is this art form about. But today we have a constantly increasing theoretical discourse on the field of sound arts, which absolutely also inform the practices themselves or the theories of sound art. I think also when we talk about the epistemological production of knowledge on sound art, has quite a lot been dominated by, I would say, phenomenological traditions of thought, which in itself it's fine, but from my perspective as a practitioner, it doesn't help me to deal with these material issues that is a central part of the practice. And I would also say that commercialization or capitalism is another factor which absolutely has affected the practice. This is quite interesting because I heard they talked about post-const in a daily newspaper 2 days ago, where we more and more meet environments which at first glance might look or is experienced as art because they kind of piratize on artistic expressions, but in the end we realize it's a part of the shopping malls, marketing itself as an artistic atmosphere. We meet it in like lounges in airports. Then that's right. Yeah, airports or shopping malls and so on. So I think that in that sound. The relation to normalization, it's been a kind of common media as well as kind of, it's been quite capitalized in that way. It's a part of capitalization. I think this is quite interesting because this also feeds in and bleeds into the artistic practices themselves. How, for instance, public commissioners ask for, what are the expectations that we are asked for as artists? This is it's an excerpt from 2015, three new artistic blah, 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 that's supposed to, that you as an artist can apply for. And I couldn't, I am yellow marked that the expectations of the sound artist, in the waiting rooms, there is a request for, what do you say, behaglig, pleasant sound art, which also should be relaxing. And I think that's, so in that sense, the relation between design and art is incredibly blurred. And these are supposed to be the kind of, shall we say, really the art commissioner of the Kulturförvaltningen or Stockholms läns landsting. And I would say that the artists solve this very, very nice, so no bad feelings about that. So I think that, in a way, all of these kind of traditions, when we talk about normalization, we talk about capitalism, they in some are built on a traditions of mimicry and representation. It's not about experimentation, but it's rather it's about repeating something that is already established. And I would say that art's capacity is to break barriers and the capacity to create new unexpected outcomes. And that's what I wanted to see. How is there a kind of possibility for me to develop the artistic approaches, or call it artistic research approaches and conceptual tools that can actually describe and articulate what's going on in the practice, and actually also be used as tool when practicing art? Big questions. So in that sense, I think it's extremely important to understand that you have to abandon ideas and mechanisms that builds on representation and transcendence, which today dominates a lot of discourses, which has to do still with spatial production. And for us who's in the field, we might found it, but yeah, we know this, we know how to do it. And I mean, there's a kind of increasing discourse on new materialism, post-humanism, etc., etc. But when you come to the commissioners and the actual curators of festivals, it's still extremely traditional, and that's something. And I also realized that this field is very little articulated. So I think it's really important to understand that spatial production must be understood as kind of transversal or interrelational force relations. If you look at this space, it's not about to insert the sound in this space. On the one hand, we can see this as an empty container filled with objects and subjects, with chairs. We can see it with an artist trying to give a presentation. But we can also see this as different kind of components or agents, with each with their specific agency, which you were highly touching upon in the first presentation. And I think that makes a huge difference, because if you try to approach spatial production from a more immanent or flat ontology approach, where you acknowledge the agencies of a site, the specific, that all kinds of material, all components have its specific agency, everything from the soil where you're digging to installing the loudspeaker cable, etc., it alters the idea of what the production and artistic production is. So in that sense, I think that sound installation could be understood as an affecting, transforming, site-specific practice, which on the one hand explores the heterogenic or complex affective components and force relations, which together constitutes a place. And on the other hand, it explores it, and on the one hand, it transforms it, because art is transformative in that sense. So in that sense, I think it's important to claim that sound installation is must be understood as a vital process. It's not about representing or repeating things. And from my perspective, as a sound installation artist, I pointed out three different approaches, which I found extremely important, which on the one hand, it's called mapping the affective lines, on the other hand, establishing new connections, and thirdly, becoming non-autonomous, which all connect to this idea of understanding places or sites as the effect of a very complex process of components and the way how I explore and actually transform a site. And I think that deals with the whole installation process, from the composition of the sonic material to the installation process to the very spatial process of setting up a creating a space. So in that sense, becoming these three approaches covers the whole process and mapping the affecting lives deals actually with the process of site-specific exploration. Instead of talking about a place or a space, it's not about representing when you do your research on a place or about in or on a space. It's not about representing, but it's about enhancing experience and deal with that as an effective body. And if one of the part of the site-specific process deals with the exploration of the affective lines or the spatial exploration, another part is, of course, tackling the complex question of how creation and development of new alternative sonic image can develop. And here, I've been very inspired or informed by Deleuze and Guattari, is the idea, the relation between the virtual and the actual. The actual is what we have here at present. This is, of course, simplification. But the virtual are the potentials of a site, which are explicitly, they are there, but they are not fully realized yet. And also becoming non-autonomous is the idea about me as an artist, because I'm always situated. I come with my specific partial perspective, and this highly affects the outcome. So it's not about me installing speakers in the space. It's about me as an artist dealing with the affective capacities of this space, and together we are forming. It's a kind of, shall we say, play between bodily forces. You were touching upon that somehow. Okay, so if we take one example, because this is sound, of course, become very abstract, and going back to currents. So in Froma, if we come back to the idea of transversality, that artistic practice is engaging and exploring and modifying a site in terms of interrelational process. Let's see what happens if we look at the currents in that way. On the one hand, you can see it as a straightforward process where the artist is collecting data from the research project, and of course setting up a kind of programming software thing, and continue to. It's a kind of straightforward process from collecting data to the. I think I should come back to sonification, because some of you might not even know what that is, and that is, it's a kind of quite big issue or quite big aesthetical field within sound and sound art and music, and it's basically the idea of representing non-audible data through sound. So representation is a very big issue in this field. So you can see it as the work represents the audified non-audible data that was taken from the research project. But from my perspective, I think one has to see the complexity in the actual process. For instance, you can see it. You have to see what is this about in terms of site-specific practice. What does it mean to explore the affective lines, or what is the site here? And in these terms, it's not only about inserting sound in a place. It's about actually a very, very complex process where I have to deal with a lot of agents through these affective bodies and agents in this process. Like we can go, we can do it like this, actually. So if we look about look at the whole sonification project, these are actually all the agents involved in the sonification projects. So it covers the global warming, the Arctic, the Gulf Stream, the transatlantic telecom cable, Faroe Telecom, blah, 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 is the Department of Meteorology, Stockholm University, a variety of the scientific research project, analysis and interpretation of data in real time, blah, blah, blah. And I mean, I could go on and we could talk about specifically on sonification, but this is not the task here. So what I want to show is that sonification, from the artistic practitioner's perspective, is a very complex transversal process where you actually have to deal with enormous different kinds of fields, spanning from the material to the discursive, nature, and so on. So that was kind of my target with this research project. This is only one project among three others. To make visible all these kind of aspects, and if you want to are interested in that, you can read the PhD. But I think this is something that rarely is kind of highlighted when we talk about sonic practices, that all these kind of complex complex dealing and complex processes that takes place before what you heard as a documentation. Yeah, I think I might be finished. Yeah.